Welcome back, our AT&T U-verse Rewind. Oh, this one never gets old. That would be the throw from the great Bo Jackson, perhaps the most famous throw in baseball history, as he nails Harold Reynolds. And then the manager, well, he didn't like that one. At least the opposing manager didn't. And we're back here to see Danny Duffy on the hill. The manager of the opposing Mariners that day was Jim LaFever. Yeah, you recognize the name. That would be the father of Ryan LaFever. And we're having the privilege right now of visiting with Jim. And Jim, let's just start with that. We'll talk about Ryan in a moment, too. But that play, what were you arguing? You went out and argued afterwards, too. But what were you thinking about when you saw that thing?
I looked at him and I said, how in the heck could that guy make a throw like that? It's impossible. You know. And no, it was just a phenomenal play. I was, Boone really sold the whole thing. First of all, Boone made one of the greatest throws in the history of the game. Two outs, we were at the bottom of the 10th inning. It was a tough ball game with 3-2 count with two outs, so obviously he's going on the ball. A line drive, Edgar Martinez hits to the wall. Harold's running, he's got to score. It's an automatic score. The game is now over in our minds. Bo goes over there, catches the ball, and with just his arm strength alone, wound up and threw the ball, and it looked like he was going to throw it out of the stadium. Had a big trajectory, and Boone stood there like this, and he waited. Here comes Harold running around, and all at once, he just catches the ball and tags him, and surprised Harold. He had no idea the ball was coming in because of the way that Bob Boone was standing there, but what a phenomenal play. And I just went out there to argue because Harold didn't know what to say, and I didn't know what to say, and I said, can you believe that? But it was by far the best throw I've ever seen.
Well, so many years in baseball as a player, as a manager, we've got the broken bat there, just going to miss Duffy, thankfully, and Infante turns the play. But, you know, to have been teammates with Sandy Koufax and Don Drysdale, so many of the greats, and you were telling us last night, you had a bunch of us over last night, so thank you for that. We had a great time. But the great speech from the legendary manager, Walter Alston. And it's a quick one, so you can sum this one up pretty good, right?
Well, Walter Alston, in 1965, I was a non-roster player. No idea that I was going to make it. So now I make the club. We're in Shea Stadium, and I'm just nervous because my first game, here we have all these Hall of Famers sitting there. Walter Alston is known for his managing. So we're waiting for him just before we go out on the field, the start of the game. He walked out, and he said very simply, gentlemen, we're here to win, and I expect to win. If you do the job, you play. If not, we'll find somebody else. Good luck. And that was it. And he walked out. He gave us our goal. He told us what he expected of. If we played well, you're going to play. If not, we'll find somebody else. How simple is that? And that's what made him such a great manager.
Yeah, like a 7 or 8 second speech there, and that was it. Well, heard so many great stories about Ryan growing up in those Dodger clubhouses. Of course, you were coaching there, later managing, and he'd come in from college and visit you when you were managing and all that. Talking to Rick Monday, Ron Safes, pardon me, recently about, you know, his kid and Ryan growing up in the clubhouse. What was it like seeing your son hanging around as a little kid in the clubhouse, getting into trouble, I'm sure?
Well, he was just a great, my son right here also would come out during the summertime, and fortunately the clubs would allow the kids to be around the clubhouse. When Ryan was there, I was managing Seattle, and he used to come in after a ball game and sit in the back and watch all the writers come in and the questions they'd ask, this and that and this and that, and then he'd notice that one or two guys would stay back, and they would come in and they would ask questions, and what they were doing is they were sizing up what all the other guys were going to say, and they were going to pick out something that was different. And so he'd come in and ask me all the questions about this and that, and of course the broadcasting crew there in Seattle, that they invited him to go up there during the games and watch the broadcast to see how they, you know. So yeah, he kind of grew up, you know, in the clubhouse, watched the media, was up in the booth, and it really paid off, I think.
Yeah, and we love obviously working with him every single day. The stories last night, had a great time hearing about the stories, playing days, managing days over in Japan and China, and meeting your family, and the little guy here right now, hopefully we can get a shot in a minute. Weston, your grandson here is chomping on some French fries, so he's loving that too. But how nice, I know we'll be potentially getting to a break here with two outs, to be sitting here, second row. Your son took care of you.
He sure did. You know, I'm not up in the the bleachers like Euchre would be having way up there in the corner up here. But no, he's been, you know, obviously he's just a special kid. He takes it serious. And the one thing I hear a lot is players from other teams would come over and say, your son is really a professional. And that makes you feel good because that's the way we played the game when I first came up. That's the way I wanted to manage. That's the way I wanted to coach. And the broadcasters that I worked with over the years, the Harry Careys, the Vin Scullys, and all those guys, you know, you take a little bit from this and a little bit that, and you develop your own style. And to see Ryan do that and have that opportunity, not too many gets to have a chance to not only be there, but on a daily basis, and see how moods change. One day players are high, they're low, this and that. And he used to ask me all the time, how do you ask this question? How do you do this and that? So he really takes it serious, and I'm so proud of him.
And you should be, and it's been great to catch up with so many of the stories. We, of course, could go on all night long, but really enjoyed that last night. Hopefully you could see a Royals win here this evening, and really appreciate the visit, Jim.
Well, you know, I enjoyed it too, because people don't realize the work you guys put behind the scenes to make the broadcast good. You're ahead of it. You know, you're always looking for things to bring up during the course of the game and how hard you work. And it's like we as players go out there, we know what we want to do. We're playing against a hard throwing left-hander. We got to approach him a certain way. But you at the same time are kind of visualizing how the game's going to be unfold. And that's what makes a good broadcasting team.
Well, I can tell you this much. Hud last night was ready to put on a uniform and get playing with the energy and the motivation. Jim Lefebvre, thank you very much. And we're proud of you and your son. More baseball coming up from here in Arizona as Danny Duffy walks off.